In this video, we're going to show you the real-world performance of DaVinci Resolve on Apple's new M4 chipset, how it compares to other Macs, both new and old, and how you can benchmark your own Resolve installation, whether it's Windows or Mac.
My earliest computing memories are of the Acorn Archimedes in the early 90s. The Archimedes had something special inside. It was the first commercially released computer to feature a brand new processor that Acorn had been developing since the mid-80s. The Acorn RISC Machine Processor, more commonly known as ARM. That sounds familiar, right? My teenage years were spent on Windows computers. I started using Intel Macs in the mid-2010s. And then, in 2021, I purchased the M1 Max MacBook Pro. Acorn officially stopped making computers in 1998, but its legacy continues because at the heart of all Apple computers sits an ARM chip that is based on a descendant of the incredible architecture that Acorn built all the way back in the 80s. My computing journey has come full circle because in a funny way, I'm sort of back where I started almost 30 years ago.
Thank you, Leon, for that adorable story. Let's get started. Much like cameras, the best computer is the one you have. If yours is already meeting your needs, you don't need to upgrade. There's a difference between needing more performance and wanting more. The M1 series was a stunning technical achievement. It's been our workhorse for the last 3 years. This is the newly released M4 Max 16-inch MacBook Pro. The transition from Intel to Apple Silicon was huge, but the M2 and M3 have been incremental improvements. But when we saw the M4's advertised performance, we felt for our needs, it was sufficient to warrant an upgrade. How much better is the M4? The answer might help you with your purchasing decisions, or better yet, convince you that your current computer is good enough. There's no point us telling you how it feels to use. We need a more objective way of comparing computers. When comparing computers, you will come across the same problems you encounter when comparing cameras. Specs or benchmarks don't always give an indication of real-world performance. Perhaps you've heard of Geekbench. It's what you would call a synthetic benchmark. It simulates workloads that resemble real-world tasks a processor might perform, but it doesn't always accurately reflect how a device will perform in specific applications. In other words, if you want to know how well DaVinci Resolve will work on a computer, you need to run DaVinci Resolve. To that end, we've made a standardized DaVinci Resolve project that we can use for benchmarking. It contains several timelines filled with clips loaded with computationally intensive effects. We're using render time to evaluate performance, as it's easier to quantify than edit or color page performance. The gains we see in the deliver page will be mirrored elsewhere in the program. Our main benchmark is built for the studio version of Resolve. We've also included one that will work with the free version. But today, we're going to focus on the studio test. Just like any other Resolve project, it will work on Windows, Mac, or Linux. We've packaged the benchmark as a DaVinci Resolve archive. Download and store it on your fastest internal drive to make sure disk access speed doesn't become a bottleneck. Your desktop will work just fine for this. And then restore the project archive to a local library. There's three different benchmarks inside. We're going to focus on the A benchmark designed for the studio version of Resolve. As mentioned, it's filled with heavy video effects that will put your GPU to the test. CPU performance is important, but for most people, GPU performance will be the bottleneck as Resolve makes heavy use of GPU acceleration. Load the timeline, head to Deliver page, choose the H.264 master preset, and add the job to the render queue. I'm going to add it several times. It doesn't matter if it overwrites the file, because all we care about is the render time. We're doing this to see if the computer has any thermal throttling issues, where it slows down when the chip gets so hot it overwhelms the computer's cooling capacity. If it does, the second and third render will give a more consistent representation of the computer's performance when under such prolonged load. We're hoping this benchmark will be useful for years to come, not just for testing computers, but we're planning to use it to test future Resolve updates on the same machine. It might help us spot things like issues or improvements in performance.
A big thanks to Audio for sponsoring this video. Here's three reasons why you should check them out. Does it take you ages finding the right music for your videos? If so, you will love Audio's Link Match AI feature. We often get inspiration from popular music we hear on streaming or on social media, but we can't license that music on our projects. But if you enter that track into Audio's Link Match AI, it will suggest tracks from its own library that match the rhythm, energy, and genre. This saves so much time. Secondly, if you want to tweak the song, you can use Audio's Elements feature to download stems. Those are separate audio tracks for each element in the song. Now you can remix the song yourself. And lastly, your audio subscription features access to a massive library of sound effects. Audio normally costs $200 a year, but right now you can get an entire year's subscription for just $60. That's insane value. Supporting our sponsors is an excellent way of supporting the content we make on our channel. Thanks for watching.
The main question we set out to answer is, how much faster is the M4 Max than the M1 Max? The answer, almost twice, but not quite. For us, doubling performance, give or take, is significant. I know this sounds obvious, but a 1 hour render is now about 30 minutes. That's a big improvement. How does that compare to other published tests? We're going to add Geekbench's synthetic metal and OpenCL scores to the screen. That's because Resolve uses your GPU to render. So as mentioned, GPU benchmarks are more relevant than CPU. And finally, let's add Apple's own performance figures from their keynote. They claimed that the M4 Max's GPU is 1.9 times faster than the M1 Max. So the M1 Max is going to be our baseline. All right, there's some work to do here. Geekbench awards a score. The higher the number, the faster your GPU. Our render time works the other way around. The lower the number, the better. So let's do some quick math to flip that number around and turn it into a score. If the M1 Max scored 100, then the M4 Max scored 180. Finally, we'll display all those stats at the same scale to make them easier to compare and add factors to show the difference between the M4 Max and our baseline. There seems to be some difference in gains between the OpenCL and Metal benchmarks. That might be optimization issues within Geekbench. Apple claims up to 1.9 times better performance. That seems like a reasonable claim given the figures we're seeing from Geekbench. Remember, they said up to. Not all workloads will see the same gains. At 1.83 times faster, Geekbench's score is acceptably close to 1.9 times. Finally, our DaVinci Resolve test timeline shows a 1.8 times increase in render speed. Again, that's in line with Apple's claimed increases. For those with lower budgets or simpler needs, what about the M4 or M4 Pro? You've likely seen other videos extolling the incredible value that they both offer. As mentioned, Mr. Alex Tech has made a fantastic video on the base spec $600 M4 Mini. He's kindly ran our benchmark timeline on it. It renders about half as slow as the M1 Max. We can safely assume that the M4 MacBook Pro has the same performance as the M4 Mac Mini. Consider this. The base spec Mac Mini costs only $600. If you want a laptop, the M4 14-inch MacBook Pro costs $1,600. A secondhand M1 Max MacBook Pro also costs around $1,600. It has twice the performance for the same price. Or alternatively, buy a Mac Mini at a third of the price. It has a much better performance to cost ratio. The M4's performance is incredible and makes a very compelling case, especially in the base spec Mac Mini. It's less compelling in the MacBook as the higher cost of making a laptop starts to dilute its value. Let's do another comparison. This time, the M4 with the M4 Max. The M4 has approximately a quarter the performance of the M4 Max. That's because it has a quarter the number of GPU cores. This is no coincidence. Performance scales almost linearly with the number of cores. So it seems reasonable to extrapolate that the M4 Pro would have around half the performance of the M4 Max as it has half the cores. What have we learned from all of this? Firstly, the M1 Max is still an incredible machine. If you already have one, you should be a very happy camper. If you're coming from an older computer, it's worth considering a secondhand M1 Max. Secondly, it's realistic to base performance expectations on Apple's stats. Obviously, with the caveat that real-world performance is dependent on many factors, so we'll likely always sit below the theoretical performance figures. And lastly, Resolve's performance scales linearly with the number of GPU cores. Would you like to see how well your computer performs? It might just be curiosity, or maybe you're trying to work out whether it's worthwhile for you to upgrade to an M4. We're very happy to make our benchmark available for free for you to use. There's a download link in the description. Once you've run your tests, please use this format to post your scores in the comments. We happen to use Mac computers, but it's possible to build some incredible Windows-based machines too. The M4 Max is an amazing laptop. It's easy to scoff at Apple's prices and compare apples to oranges. A cheaper custom-built desktop Windows machine might outpace this computer, but it doesn't have an inbuilt screen or keyboard. It can't be carried and consumes hundreds of watts of power. The M4 Max MacBook Pro has incredible performance, efficient power consumption, and comes in this elegant package. When compared to Apple's other M4 models, you will pay a premium. If your work can justify this sort of expenditure, you know who you are and you'll understand how to get a return on your investment. On the other hand, maybe the M4 Max isn't for you. Perhaps you're trying to work out which M4 model you should get. Don't forget, some specs offer more value than others. Here's a little overview. The M4 Mac Mini is incredible value, especially the base spec. The M4 Pro offers similar performance to Apple's flagship M1 Max from 3 years ago, but for a lower price when purchased new. The M4 Max offers the absolute best performance currently available, but obviously at a higher cost as it's only available in the MacBook Pro currently. If you're willing to wait until maybe next year, we'd imagine the Mac Studio will be updated with the M4 Max and M4 Ultra chip, which will bring the cost of owning an M4 Max down to somewhere around the $2,100 mark. Finally, don't forget, you could always pick up a secondhand M1 Max. Whatever you decide, consider your needs, and if you're a working professional, have a plan of how it will contribute towards your work. If you have questions, leave them down in the comments below. If you're new to Resolve, whether that's because you're a new editor or you're moving from another NLE, we've made an awesome course for you. If you want a taste of it, check out our free masterclass on YouTube or go watch the free sample lesson. Sure, you can try and figure things out yourselves, but if you want to get the most out of Resolve and work effectively, there's no substitute for a proper expert-guided course. And hey, a big thanks to Audio for sponsoring this video. We really appreciate the support they give our channel. Go watch Alex's videos on the M4 Mini, and don't forget, give this video a like if you found it helpful. And make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss out on future videos. See you next time.